This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Grace to you and peace in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and welcome to worship at the First Presbyterian Church of Warminster, and a special welcome to those who worship with us through WRDV-FM radio. Welcome. Today's flowers are dedicated to the glory of God by Judy Perry in honor of Anita's birthday, and by Don Sachs in memory of Dorothy Sachs. Our only prayer request today is that we all give thanks to God for Dell, who will turn 105 years old this coming Friday, February 12th. We are so thankful for Dell's long life of witness, friendship, and loving family. Happy birthday, Dell, far in advance, but we will be celebrating with you all week long. Today, we will be celebrating the Sacrament of Communion with the Reverend Dr. Keith Lawrence presiding at the Lord's table, along with your fellow participants, Joan, Linda R., Walt, Linda H., Carol, and myself. So please have something to eat and drink with you later in the service so that we can all partake together. Children are welcome to the Lord's table. And if you belong to another Christian tradition, please know that you are welcome to join us in this sacrament. Today, we also will be receiving our Super Bowl of Caring offering. And it's a youth-inspired movement working across the country to tackle hunger in local communities. And it mobilizes grassroots resources, including churches, schools, civic organizations, and individuals, and has raised over $160 million worth of support that stays completely local. So you can still make your Super Bowl of Caring offering to the church. Just if you write a check, please designate on the check that it is for that special offering. Mail it to the church, or you can drop it by, and we will make sure that it counts toward our collective offering. Today is a special Sunday also. This is Scout Sunday, and we are so blessed to have members and leaders of Boy Scout Troop 139 leading worship today. Unfortunately, due to COVID precautions, we will not be able to enjoy the troop's annual pancake fundraising breakfast this year, but they are holding a Krispy Kreme donut sale for the same fundraiser. Your orders and payment are due by this Tuesday, February 9th, so please contact Sue Murphy if you would like to contribute towards this fundraiser and enjoy what I claim to be the most delicious donuts in the world. And if donuts are not on your diet, you can still make a donation to this fundraiser. Again, please contact Sue Murphy and she will facilitate your contribution for the troop. Today's liturgists are all from Troop 139. They are Tyler E., Vince, Jeremy, Jake, Tyler T., Aiden, Tommy, and Colin, with Connor joining them in the color guard. Their scout leaders are Jason, Mark, Steve, Tom, Sean, Tony, and Josh, who also filmed and produced the troop's participation. And our own Sue Murphy is the troop's charter organization representative, and she will offer today's benediction at the end of worship. Today's musical gifts are offered by Kathy Worth Balkus on organ and piano. And our hymn singers are Joan, Linda H., Sue G., Jonna, Jenny, Carol, and Cindy, conducted by our director of music, Dave Sathra. And now Troop 139 will present the color guard, followed by a special message from Scoutmaster Jason.
Thank you. Scott's attention. Scott's uniform salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Two. Scott's eye. Scott oath. On my honor,
I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country, to obey the Scout Law, to help other people at all times, keep myself physically strong, mentally awake, and morally straight.
Scout Law.
Scout is trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent.
Two.
Hello and welcome, Congregation and Troop 139. I'm Jason Tumulty, the Scoutmaster for Troop 139. In talking about Scout Sunday, I'd like to leave the Scouts and the congregation with these words. This one is called the Spiritual Compass. For Scouts on a hike or a canoe trip, a compass is an important tool because it gives you a stable reference point, magnetic north. You can set a course and follow it. As long as your compass is accurate and you don't damage it, you will serve you faithfully if you trust it. Our faith or our spirituality is something like that. We have a point of reference that does not change, God. And when we have a compass, so to speak, in our relationship with God, it's something we have learned and continue to learn about, just as we learn to use the compass properly. We use our spirituality and faith to get us through the grind journey we call life. If we are prepared to trust the things we have learned about God, our spirituality can guide us through this journey, through our joys and temptations of life. We can use it to show us that service can give the potential dangers and keep them away from us. You can use it to guide us in our friendships, in our work, with our troop, our scouts, and what people say about people, and in how we treat the entire natural world.
The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Our worship continues with the morning prelude.
Thank you.
Before turning to scripture, let us pray. O God, by your Spirit, tell us what we need to hear and show us what we ought to do to obey Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21 through 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them, and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing.
Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my light is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strength to the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Oh, Psalm 147, praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God, for His graces and the song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds their wounds. He determines the number of their stars. He gives to them all of their names. Great is the Lord, and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure.
The Lord lifts up the downtrodden. He casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. He covers the heavens with clouds, prepares rain for the earth, makes grass grow on the hills. He gives the animals their food, and to the young ravens when they cry. His delight is not the strength of the horse, nor his pleasure in the speed of a runner. But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, and those who hope in his steadfast love. Praise the Lord.
1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 16 to 23. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me. And woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel.
For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew, in order to win the Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but I am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might be all that means save some. I do not do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share its blessing.
Mark chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew, with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases, and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him.
In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to the deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also. For that is what I came out to do." And he went through Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The word eagle is mentioned 30 times in the Bible, and it's used to describe the surpassing strength of God to empower his people to obey and to place all their trust in the Lord alone. And two things about eagles were noted in ancient times. First, that eagles are swift and quick moving, and second, they can soar so high above the earth that they were believed to be able to fly as high as the sun. In other words, eagles can move fast and far. And according to Isaiah, that's what it looks like when God strengthens and empowers his people, especially when they are at their weakest and most vulnerable. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Now, our gospel lesson from Mark doesn't mention eagles, but what they symbolize in scripture is central to our passage today. And not only in this passage, but throughout all of Mark's gospel, because he is all about telling us how fast and how far Jesus carries the good news into the world. And although he doesn't use the word eagle to describe Jesus's ministry, Mark does favor a certain word that he uses over 40 times throughout his gospel. And that word is immediately. In the first chapter of Mark alone, that word comes at us 7 times. Immediately, Jesus emerges from the waters of the Jordan at his baptism. Immediately, the Spirit compels him into the wilderness. Immediately, Andrew and Peter drop their nets and follow Jesus. Immediately, Jesus calls James and John. Immediately, Jesus teaches on the Sabbath in the synagogue at Capernaum. Immediately, he leaves the synagogue and goes to Peter and Andrew's house. And immediately, they bring to Jesus Peter's mother-in-law, who is sick with fever. So Mark uses that word so often that for a long time, his writing style was dismissed by biblical scholars who thought that he was lazy or ineloquent for using that word so much. And even today, English translations of the New Testament Greek will often substitute the word immediately with synonyms such as soon as or at once. And that happens at least twice in today's passage. But doing that by trying to smooth over the overuse of that word waters down the impact that Mark is trying to make in his message. Because the Greek word that we translate as immediately has layers of meaning that go beyond just the time-related sense of the word. It has physical and spatial dimensions as well, because the Greek word also means straight, upright, and direct, which I think is why Mark uses the word so often. He doesn't just want us to see Jesus's mission as fast-paced, but that it has an unwavering aim and purpose. And it's no coincidence that the word immediately first appears at his baptism, signifying that from the moment the Father anoints his Son, the divine purpose for this world has been launched, like an eagle flying from its nest, moving straight away, upright, and in a particular direction toward its target. In other words, Mark is telling us that Jesus always stays focused on the magnetic north of his calling. And nowhere is that seen so clearly than in how Mark describes Jesus's first day of public ministry in today's passage, when he gives the town of Capernaum the full gospel treatment. He preaches, he teaches, he casts out demons and heals the sick. And by sundown, the entire population stands outside Peter and Andrew's house waiting to be healed and made clean by Jesus. So obviously, the disciples are impressed by what they see, which is why they can't understand why Jesus would suddenly up and leave in the middle of the night. If Jesus has called them to fish for people, isn't that just what happened in Capernaum? Everyone there loves Jesus. He's a hit. He's famous. The plan is working. The fish are jumping right into the nets, and he wants to leave Capernaum? Why not put down roots in that very place and let everyone come to him? But Jesus doesn't see his mission in that way, because there are other people and other towns who need him to go to where they are. It's time to leave Capernaum. Mark's emphasis on the urgency and movement of Jesus's ministry invites us to reflect on mission and discipleship. To reflect on how the gospel is not given to us as a possession, but as a claim on our lives to extend the good news beyond ourselves. And to reflect on how the church isn't a place, but a movement. When Jesus shows his disciples that there are other people in other neighborhoods to share the gospel, he teaches us that, like Capernaum, the church might be where we gather for strength and renewal and healing, but ultimately, the church is a launching pad. The disciples show us that we too must follow Jesus to points far beyond Capernaum. This passage from Mark is a corrective against any notion that the church exists only as an outpost set apart from a hostile world, a safe harbor where all of us speak the same language and share the same values. And to an important extent, the church is supposed to be that for us. Church is a community where Christians find fellowship and nurture that we know we can't find anywhere else. We know, not just in our minds, but deep in our bones, that without church as our home base, we lose our identity, our sense of purpose, and that without gathering every Sunday, we'll have no anchor for the week ahead. We know that without the church's provision of spiritual and communal nourishment at the Lord's table, we will starve out there, even while surrounded by abundance. We need the church as a place to come together to hear and recite and celebrate Christ's Spirit at work in our lives, because we know that apart from him and apart from each other, we have no purpose. But what we have to remember is that church is not the only place where divine things happen. Just as troop meetings aren't the only place where scouting happens. But it is the starting place. Church is where the Lord renews our strength and then sends us flying out into the world. And Jesus is already out there ahead of us. He is our compass. And all he needs us to do is to trust and to follow him immediately. Because when worship is over, when church committees accomplish their work, when Bible studies and annual meetings and Sunday school classes come to an end, it's time to leave Capernaum and follow Jesus. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord will stand forever. Amen.
We come to you, Lord. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." This is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites all who trust in him to share the feast which he has prepared. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us pray. Holy God, we praise you. You are the light of all faithful hearts. We rejoice that you made us in your image and call us to live in your love. You gave us breath and speech that all the living might sing your praise with choirs of angels and with the faithful of every time and place. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is your only Son, Jesus, whom you sent to light the way and to lead us to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. We rejoice in the love of Jesus, whose glory shone forth even when confronted with the cross. Gracious God, by your Spirit, pour out your grace on this bread and this cup, that they may become for us the presence of Christ among us. Shine your light and your love on the offering of our lives. Enlighten us that we may be your people, the body of the risen Christ, set apart to serve this world that you have made. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we praise you now and forever. O eternal light, as we pray, as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but to his kingdom and our glory forever. Amen." The Lord Jesus, on the night that he of his arrest, took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The bread of life, take and eat.
And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, remember me." Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes. Let us pray. Loving God, you have given us a share in the one bread and the one cup, and you have made us one with Christ. Help us to bring your light and joy to all the world. This we ask through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen.
now please receive this benediction. And now as you leave this place, may the living Lord, the God of love, go with you. May he go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you in obedient ministry, above you to watch over you, within you to give you his power, and before you to show you the way. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, shalom and amen. Go in peace.
There comes a time in the life of every young man for serious contemplation and wise evaluation concerning his future. For decisions determine destiny.
The scout, in his promise, undertakes to do his duty to his king and country only in the second place. His first duty is to God. There is a higher mission before us, namely the promotion of the kingdom of God. That is the rule of peace and goodwill on earth.
Duty to God means a lot more than saying a prayer every time you need a favor. A lot more. Duty to God is simply that voluntary gesture you must make and remake a million times in your lifetime as a statement of your recognition that there's someone above this universe who watches over this universe. By unto whom each of us is a favorite son.
Believe in anything you want to believe in, but keep God at the top of it. With him, life can be a beautiful experience. Without him, well, you're just biding time.
I am pleased to stand firm for an organization that teaches duty to God and country, that embraces the Scout Law. Yes, an organization whose motto is Be Prepared, and whose slogan is, Do a Good Turn Daily.
We scouts count ourselves a brotherhood despite the difference among us of country, creed, or class. There is no religious side to the movement. The whole of it is based on religion. That is, on the realization and service of God.